When the First World War began, a bard was born. Dylan Thomas was to be the greatest bard in Wales after Dafydd ap Gwilym, who died over 500 years before at Tully Abbey and was buried by the sheep and the waters. Better the heart abstain and poetry be still, on prayers use your skill. Wise advice, but it would not later suit Dylan. The name meant a son of the wave. He was an angel child by his mother's lap. His great-uncle Gwilym Marle, Dylan's middle name, was a preacher and a bard and a firebrand, who was thrown out of his chapel by a squire. Dylan grew up and played and picnicked with his sister Nancy and his friends. He was to write about Wales in the 1930s, before the Second World War against Hitler.
In the docks of the south, they fight with ropes and cranes and hoists. They load the ships to slide into the mined and death-sprung waters, and all the quays are alive, loud with war. In the Rhondda Valley, they fight with pick and shovel and drill. They fight the cruel, obstinate, dark rock middles of the mountains for minerals and metals. They go down into the splintered darknesses of the mines, into the blind, propped underworld with horses and canaries. They go down like ghosts in black. Only their smiles are white.
Dylan's father was a schoolteacher, and the boy lived in a Swansea villa. His family was not toiling in the shop soiling factories. He was not living in the slums, and the foul air, smutting the slipshod roofs. And the games he played at school were not on the rascal paving stones of the ragamuffin streets.
Dickie. Kiss me in milk ward, Dickie, or give me a penny, quickly.
Granny, Granny, I can't kiss you in milk ward.
Granny, ask him why.
Why? Because my mother said I mustn't.
Cowdy, cowdy custard, give Granny a penny.
Give me a penny.
I haven't got any.
But the singing in the chapels is never grim or grey. The voices of colliers or shepherds, quarrymen or small farmers, tradesmen from the scorched valleys, or ploughmen from the long fields, the voices of children brought up to play Indians on the slag heaps, or pirates in the cattle-voiced meadows, are sweet and powerful, wild and gentle as the weather over the mountains, or the wind-like movements of light and shadow through the high, chill streets.
But Dylan knew none of this when he was born in 5 Cymdonkin Drive in this house in 1914. He could look down over the park, where he could play in the trees and the bushes. The old port lay below the hills behind the town hall, and he could run down to the tram lines. The lines ran along the high street, and the trams would trundle along Oxford Street and Union Street, rattling and shaking all the way, thunder in the drums of your ears. And you could take the Mumbles tramway to the train on the Mumbles railway, getting up steam. And the railway line running by the sands all around the bay. There the boy broke out in the sea and the free beyond. Ach, let me in. Inside was the old courtyard, all pinkwash and door green. Dylan loved his Aunt Annie at the farm at Fern Hill, and she loved him, and he would write a poem about his happiness there.
Now as I was young and easy under the apple boughs, about the lilting house and happy as the grass was green, the night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb, golden in the heydays of his eyes. And honoured among wagons, I was prince of the apple towns, and once below a time, I lordly had the trees and leaves, trail with daisies and barley down the rivers of the windfall light. And green and golden, I was huntsman and herdsman, the calves sang to my horn, the foxes on the hills barked clear and cold, and the Sabbath rang slowly in the pebbles of the holy stream. All the sun long it was running, it was lovely, the hay fields high as the house, the tunes from the chimneys. It was air and playing, lovely and watery, and fire green as grass. And nightly, under the simple stars, as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long I heard, blessed among stables, the nightjars flying with the ricks, and the horses flashing into the dark.
The boy also learned the Bible and the Huil from the fire and brimstone preaching of his uncle, the Reverend Rees. Though he didn't like Sunday school lessons under time and the promise he'd live forever, he would rather be mudlarking on the seaweedy shore before running home across the park. And who was waiting for him inside? He described his mother Florence in his autobiographical work, Adventures in the Skin Trade, stout, safe, confident, buried in her errands, his sister, with all the long legs and the young liberals' dances, and the boys you brought home for supper on Sunday evenings. Most of the history sheets on the table were already marked and damned in his schoolmaster father's violent writing. Oh yes, I remember him well, the boy you are searching for. He looked like most boys, no better, brighter, or more respectful. He cribbed, mitched, spilt ink, rattled his desk and garbled his lessons with the worst of them. He could smudge, hedge, smirk, wriggle, wince, whimper, blarney, badger, blush, deceive, be devious, stammer, improvise, assume offended dignity or righteous indignation as though to the manner born. He scuffled at prayers. He interpolated smugly the time-honored wrong, irreverent words into the morning hymns. He helped to damage the headmaster's rhubarb, was 33rd in trigonometry, and, as might be expected, edited the school magazine. His early and best friend was Daniel Jones, who took him home to Warmley, which chimed with music and the arts. There they edited their first magazine. And Dylan's other great friend was Vernon Watkins. They swam together. And they would argue all the time, all their lives. He would always remember Cwmdonkin Park, outside his own front door, as full of terror and treasures, caverns and forests, prairies and deserts. As he wrote in a later poem, The Hunchback in the Park, he made all day until bell time, a woman figure without fault, straight as a young elm, straight and tall from his crooked bones, that she might stand in the night after the locks and chains, all night in the unmade park, after the railings and shrubberies, the birds, the grass, the trees, the lake, and the wild boys, innocent as strawberries, had followed the hunchback to his kennel in the dark. In his sad radio play, Return Journey, Dylan Thomas saw himself at the end of his life and his tether, going back to Swansea to look for the young man he was then. The bar was just opening. I said, good morning.
A pint of bitter, please. I wonder if you remember a friend of mine. He used to come to this bar some years ago, every morning, about this time.
What's his name?
Young Thomas.
Lots of Thomases round here. It's a kind of home from home for Thomases. What's he like?
He'd be about 17 or 18.
I was 17 once.
And above medium height. Above medium height for Wales, I mean. He's 5'6½. Speaks rather fancy. Truculent. Plausible. A bit of a shower off. Plus fours and no breakfast, you know. A bombastic, adolescent, provincial bohemian with a thick knotted artist tie, which he made out of his sister's scarf. She never knew where it had gone. And a cricket shirt, dyed bottle green. A gabbing, ambitious, mock tough, pretentious young man. And moley, too.
There's words. What do you want to find him for? I wouldn't touch him with a barge pole, would you?
I seem to remember a chap like you described. There couldn't be two like him, let's hope. He used to work as a reporter. Down the Three Lamps, I used to see him lifting his little elbow.
What's the Three Lamps like now?
It isn't like anything. It isn't there. There's nothing, man. You remember Ben Evans' stores? It's right next door to that. Ben Evans isn't there now either.
I walked down High Street, where all the shops had been. Edishaw Furnitures, Curry's Bicycles, Donegal Clothing Company, Dr. Scholl's, Burton Taylor's, W.H. Smith, Boots Cash Chemists, Leslie's Stores, Ups and Shoes, Prince of Wales, Tucker's Fish, Stead and Simpson. All the shops bombed and vanished. Past the hole in space where Hodges and Clothiers had been, down Castle Street, past the remembered invisible shops, and in the falling winter morning I walked on through the havoced centre where once a very young man I knew had mucked about, as chirpy as a sparrow after the sips and titbits and small change of the town. The castle. It was ruined, you see. But the museum was still standing. Should be in a museum.
O Santiana with the Gorn. Ay, O Santiana.
And the antelope down by the docks where I played darts, if I could stick it in the cork, like a bomb on target.
Mein heart rein. Mae'r hath ei gyd fel ffin o rew, ai o Santiana.
And then down onto the wharves, where they were still working, loading the ships and the barges, all sooty from the even fall of the dark. I stopped a man whose face I thought I recognized from a long time ago. I said,
I wonder if you can tell me.
Yes?
I said, I wonder if you can tell me whether you used to know a chap called Young Thomas. He worked on the post and used to wear an overcoat, sometimes with the check lining inside out, so you could play giant drafts on him. He wore a conscious woodbine, too.
What do you mean, conscious woodbine?
And a perched pork pie. And he tried to slouch like a news hawk.
Oh, him. He owes me half a crown. I haven't seen him since the old Cardoma days. He wasn't a reporter then, he just left the grammar school. Him, sipping coffee dashes and arguing the toss.
What about?
Music and poetry, painting and politics. Einstein, Epstein, Stravinsky, Greta Garbo, death and religion, Picasso and girls. And then communism, symbolism, Bradman, Braque, the Watch Committee, free love, free beer, murder, Michelangelo, ping pong, ambition, Sibelius and girls.
Is that all?
How Dan Jones was going to compose the most prodigious symphony and Fred James paint the most miraculously meticulous picture of Vernon Watkins and young Thomas write the most boiling poems. How they would ring the bells of London and paint it like a tart.
And after that,
the hissing of the butt ends in the drains of the coffee dashes and the tinkle and the gibble-gabble of the morning young lounge lizards as they talked about Augustus John, Emil Jennings, Carnera, Dracula, Amy Johnson, trial marriage, pocket money, the Welsh Sea, the London Stars, King Kong, anarchy, T.S. Eliot, darts, and girls. Dew, it's cold.
But what else did young Thomas do before he rang the bells of London and painted it like a tart?
In his unfinished novel, Adventures in the Skin Trade, Dylan called himself Samuel Bennett. He had a fantasy of how he left his home in Swansea. He had gone out drinking goodbye with his Welsh friends while his mother and sister packed his suitcase. After the family went to bed and time clocked on, he came in at dawn and he smashed up the parlour. He never wanted to be able to go home again. Even in the first moment of his guilt and shame, he remembered to put out his tongue and taste the track of the tears. Still crying, he said, "It's salt. It's very salt. Just like in my poems. Look at London flying by me. Buses and glowworms, umbrellas and lampposts, cigarettes and eyes under the water doorways. I am dancing with three strangers down Edgware Road in the rain," cried Samuel to the gliding boy around him. Light and without will as a suit of feathers, he held onto their arms, and the umbrella rode above them like a bird. My place is among the beggars and the outlaws. The artist Mervyn Levy also came from Swansea and was Dylan's flatmate in those pre-war days in Chelsea.
He was a very bad stable companion too, in that he didn't like paying his rent. This irritated him greatly. Not unnaturally, because like most of us in those days, he didn't really have any money, but somebody had to find the rent. The chap who always looked after the rent and who was most capable and most businesslike was Alfred James, of course, who was drawn and painted Dylan quite a number of times. And very often it meant that Fred James, who was a great big, strong, tough, burly bloke, would simply collar Dylan when he was behind with his rent and literally, I remember on one occasion, turn him upside down and shake whatever money there was in Dylan out onto the floor.
Then Dylan became engaged to the very respectable young writer, Miss Pamela Hansford Johnson, who remembered him.
He was very excited about the publication of 18 poems. He took tremendous care to choose them. He was quite determined that he wasn't going to have any nonsensical title. He was very keen on that. So he said, "Mine's going to be called 18 Poems. I'm not going to have a preface. I'm not going to have any photograph." Well, when it came out, one has to realize there was a rather long time lag between it being accepted and the book coming out, of course. During that time, he had become fairly well known. I used to sit with him. We used to go and have very happy evenings in the gardens of the Six Bells, the pub in Chelsea, which was then opened onto a bowling green and had a little fountain. And we would talk, and then he'd suddenly say, I got a wonderful phrase, and write it down. And then he'd sometimes say, let's have a game. Let's write a poem together, you see. He did drink very much for effect at that time. It was very strange. I remember that he would fake it. I'd been sitting with him in the Sick Bells, and we'd had something very modest, like a pint apiece during the whole evening, very modest. Then gone out into the street, met some of his friends, and Dylan would immediately have played drunk. It was somehow a romantic thing to be.
Dylan took to Chelsea and London like a drake to drinking ducks. He lived by cadging, reviewing and publishing a few poems. He was continually short of sleeping places near to his pubs, and he would find himself in a convenient bed more often than a chosen one. Once he said, oh God, I'm so tired of sleeping with women I don't even like. Asked why he drank so much, he said, because they expected of me, until he came to a full stop. He wasted much of his early genius on talking, not writing, at the Café Royal with the artists, when they went strolling in the Soho streets, under the rain and the violins, delivering goodies in a basket, among the barroom and café babble. Dylan's early prose and poetry were becoming obscure and clotted because he fell under the influence of the Dadaists and the Surrealists, particularly the films of Louis Buñuel. At their 1936 exhibition in London, he was outclassed by Salvador Dali and Max Ernst and others. He only passed round boiled string in a teacup. He ended up as unlikely and uncomfortable as Cocteau's Blood of a Poet. Back on the town in Soho, Dylan was to meet the love of his life, soon to be his wife. She was Kathleen McNamara, a freestyle dancer with a wild spirit in her. She was the mistress of the aged painter Augustus John, who still thought he was young, and so he painted himself. As well as painting Kathleen. After a drunken fight in Wales, John knocked down Dylan, but the poet ran away with Kathleen and married her and wrote to her, we'll always be young and unwise together. There is, I suppose, in the eyes of the they, a sort of sweet madness about you and me, a sort of mad bewilderment and astonishment, oblivious to the nasties and the meanies. But Mussolini and Hitler were pushing Europe into a Second World War. And such wonder and spoilt innocence couldn't last into the realities of marriage, and later three children. The remarkable thing was that Dylan and Kathleen didn't change their lifestyles much, at least not the pubbing and the boozing, and even the casual sex, when they had the opportunity and a quid or two. Why not live for the day and leave the bills for tomorrow? At first, the outbreak of hostilities in Europe seemed quite a laugh. There was a phony war in France and no bombs. Dylan didn't want to fight. He hated ceremony and dressing up. Luckily, he wasn't called up to be a soldier because of asthma and poor health. Anyway, he thought the whole conflict was stupid. Where was anyone going? Soho was the air raid shelter, and the best of the shelters was the York Minster, the French pub.
How to survive the Blitz. Bombs don't hit pubs, or we wouldn't be here.
We're only here because they've still got beer. Have beer, have beer. And because you're not in the army. Asthma, my eye. More like smoker's coffee. Like the one they'll carry you off in.
You'll see.
Yeah.
You'll be sorry. I'm worse than Keats. I'm a TB poet.
A DT's poet? How do we get our name? The Dylan Thomases. The DT.
I'm doing my war work.
Oh, your fighting is by making documentaries, is it? About a hole in the ground. No, it's not a mouse hole. It's a bomb.
I'm good for morale. And good for the morgue. You'll see, Cat. You'll see too late.
And what about your bloody poetry? Isn't that why we live on debts and biscuits?
You know my bloody poetry. Oh, no work of words now for 3 lean months in the bloody belly of the rich year in the big purse of my body. I bitterly take to task my poverty and craft. To take, to give is all. Return what is hungrily given. Puffing the pounds of manna up through the dew to heaven. The lovely gift of the gap bangs back on a blind shaft. It's blood. That's the stuff.
That's bloody self-pity, that is.
I'll get rich from the films, just you see. Cinema's my forte, not bloody poetry.
Unless the war gets us first. And it will.
Of course, a bomb never did fall on them in the end. While Catelyn and her babies camped in Chelsea and Hammersmith, and later in Oxford and Newquay in Wales, Dylan travelled, writing war documentaries for Strand Films, including one about barrage balloon operators from the Women's Auxiliary Air Force.
At 6 o'clock in the morning.
On a reviewing stand with the Lady Commandant, Dylan said, "You have the most superb body, ma'am, of women." Making documentaries refined Dylan's prose. He had to write for a mass audience, and it made his poetry less obscure. In fact, though he wrote few poems during the war, they were his best work. He also wrote on the Blitz on Coventry.
On the 14th November, 1940, it became a city of destruction. For 3 nights, the German bombers attacked in their fullest force. This introduced a new word into the vocabulary of mass murder, to Coventrate. Large areas of the city were devastated, the hospital was destroyed, 40 churches, 14 schools, 60,000 houses were damaged out of a total of 75,000. 1,252 men, women and children lost their lives.
The majesty and burning of the child's death. I shall not murder the mankind of her going with a grave truth, nor blaspheme down the stations of the breath with any further elegy of innocence and youth. Deep with the first dead lies London's daughter, robed in the long friends, the grains beyond age, the dark veins of her mother, secret by the unmourning water of the riding Thames. After the first death, there is no other.
Dylan's most successful and witty propaganda film was These Are the Men.
Who set us at the throats of our comrades? Who is to blame? What men set man against man? Shout! Shout, shout out their name. These are the men. These are to blame. I was born of poor parents. I grew into a discontented and neurotic child. My lungs were bad. My mother spoiled me and secured my exemption from military service. Consider my triumphant path to power. I took up art. I gave up art because I was incompetent. I became a bricklayer's laborer, a house painter, a paper hanger, a peddler of pictures, a lance corporal, a spy on socialists and communists, a hater of Jews and trade unions. I am a normal man. I do not like meat, drink, or women. Neurosis, charlatanism, bombast, anti-socialism, hate of the Jews, treachery, murder, race insanity. I am the leader of the German people. You obeyed your leader's word. You must suffer his reward. And the betrayers are betrayed. And the promises of victory turn stale and sour under African sun and Russian snow. Where is your triumph now? In the purgatories of Stalingrad? How many of you will never return to the towns and villages you know?
Dylan himself spoke on how everybody wanted to go home once the war was over.
Here are people in Britain. The people. People pouring in the evening from the roaring factories. People in the big cities, bustling from offices with umbrellas and bags and satchels in a homeward hubbub to the suburbs. Coal black, flocking back from the midnight-coloured underground of the pits, streaming out into the restless, teeming streets, from the quays and the wharves and the engine shops of the great thronged docks, the funnel-steepled town of ships. From crowds on the islands and queues at the stops, shopping, bus-hopping, scurrying, hurrying, out of the terrific traffic's clamour, into the dimmer, never still echoing station where, out of all of us, all the people, look at three soldiers going home.
Dylan managed to get his family back to Wales at the end of the war to a bungalow called Majoda in Newquay. There were three children, Llewellyn, and Iron called Ironwy, and baby Colm. If Dylan thought the war was over in seaside Wales, he was wrong. Soldiers were also returning.
Streets like dingy corridors, through the straggled drab districts that crawl from the great centres, out of the city, rattling over tram lines, out of the dank grey thoroughfares, into the wider spaces where trees are still green and the only smoke comes from houses, the unspoiled air that should belong to everybody, where a man may be proud of his own place and of his own city.
A soldier came back to Newquay, and he was jealous about his wife and Dylan. After a fight outside the Black Lion, The soldier burst into Majoda with a submachine gun and a grenade, and he peppered the walls and ceilings with shots. He was disarmed by Dylan, who managed to protect his family at last. He and Catelyn could walk from the bungalow down to the woods and St. Ina's Church by the sea. At this time, he was writing his best poetry. The year of the end of the war and his return to Wales brought about the flowering of his genius. From the slow killing of the city, he had to take refuge in his own country to think and be the bard he wanted to be. As his daughter later remembered,
"My father was Dylan, and he chose to call me Iron, although in my baptism and birth certificate I was called Iron Owen, if I'm to pronounce it the proper Welsh name, and I think he found it a bit of a mouthful. The more I remember, the more I remember. And we would go for miles till we got to the other end of Larne, and then we'd walk back from the church and we'd end up at Brown's Hotel where my father was. And I would lurk outside, because children weren't allowed in those days. I'd wait outside until they both decided to come home, and then you'd walk back again. And if my father wasn't ready to come home, because he was the victim of a very rigid routine, self-imposed, and if it wasn't time for him to come back, we'd extend the walk and we'd go right down to the Grist, which is the other end of Larne, the flat sea level end, and we'd walk up. This is my mother and I. My father wasn't this energetic. We'd walk up to the top of Sir John's Hill, and I can still remember the smell of all the wild honeysuckle. It was a beautiful walk there. This side of the truth you may not see, my son, king of your blue eyes, in the blinding country of youth, that all is undone. Under the unminding skies of innocence and guilt. Before you move to make one gesture of the heart and head is gathered and spilt into the winding dark like the dust of the dead.
But the family peace in Wales was continually ruined by the need of Dylan to earn money in London to keep from ruin. He found it not in writing films now, but in writing and performing for the BBC. Dylan would gather in the George with the other actors and producers to drink till closing time. But the problem was, time never closed. One night, with Louis MacNeice and Richard Burton, the question was, what was the greatest poem in the world? MacNeice spoke his own barroom matins, while Burton did a bit of Hamlet. But Dylan said,
"I will tell you what is the greatest poem in the world. Not one of mine, but I am. Thou art. He, she, and it is. We are. You are. They are."
In his bardic way, Dylan was still looking for patrons to keep him and his family. He found one in the wealthy Margaret Taylor, the wife of an Oxford historian who taught at Magdalen College here. She lent them a dank summer house on the River Charwell at the bottom of her garden in Hollywell Ford, although she would end by buying for the Thomas family their final refuge, the boathouse at Larne, waiting and watching from his writing caravan by the river. Dylan could look over another iron fence to the animals caged in the deer park of his Oxford College hosts. His way was not to visit the Bodleian Library with its priceless manuscripts. He preferred the pubs of London to escape from the crying children. and Catelyn, who could not stand being kept by a rival woman. And on his way back to Larn by train, he'd drink in the Mermaid in Mumblesh. Dylan and Catelyn and the three children were living in a boathouse on the estuary. Dylan wrote to Margaret Taylor, thanking her for the peace she had bought for him. Oh, to sit there, lost, found, alone in the universe, at home, at last. The people all with their arms open. The best house, the only castle, the mapped, measured, uninhabited, drained, garaged, town-halled, pubbed and churched, shopped, gold and estuaried. One state of happiness. Dylan did his writing in a shed on stilts at the back of the boathouse. He pinned family photographs on the wooden wall as he wrote his poems. They all ate under a Welsh dresser, hoping the china wouldn't fall or be chucked at each other.
In my craft or sullen art, exercised in the still night when only the moon rages and the lovers lie abed with all their grief in their arms, I labor by singing light, not for ambition or bread or the strut and trade of charms on the ivory stages, but for the common wages of their most secret heart, not for the proud men. Apart from the raging moon, I write on these spindrift pages, nor for the towering dead with their nightingales and psalms, but for the lovers, their arms round the griefs of the ages, who pay no praise or wages, nor heed my craft or art.
And then Dylan and Catelyn went slowly along the main street to the village pump, where the gossips were. And beer at Brown's Hotel.
Did you hear the one about the man in the pub? Went to take a leak, so left a note on his beer. I've spat in it. And he came back to find, scribbled on the bottom, so have I.
That was me. I'm not going to let you go to America. You won't come back. You're past it.
And the Irish firing squad? They don't form a line, they form a circle. About turn, point their guns inwards and fire. Only the victim survives.
They'll eat you alive in New York.
Oh, yes. They'll gobble me up for breakfast. I'm so bloody famous, am I?
Everybody wants a piece of you now, and you can't even pay the bloody bills. I'll have to go on the streets, I will.
There's only one street in Larn, and no takers.
Don't you be so bloody cocksure. You will not go.
I have to pay the bills and fuel the engine. Here's to you, blithe spirit. Did you hear that one about Lorca before they shot him in Spain? He had poet's block, you see, just like me. Well, in front of the firing squad, they make him dig his grave. But when they come to shoot him, the officer finds him smiling. And why? Well, he says, a plot at last.
Do not go.
I'm going to lecture in America, you know. He who is about to die, salute me. But I'll dream trip my fag end, and I'll sail away to the USA most poetically. They never grow up there, and I never did. I won't get older, will I? Promise me, Cat. Will I?
Good evening, culture vultures. And welcome to this roly-poly word binge. The self-styled Rambo of Cwmdonkin Drive, Swansea, or poor man's Charles Laughton. Above average height and fearless. Above average height for Wales, I mean. 5'6½". With the face of an excommunicated cherub, a nose that's polished every day, a body when clothed once so cruelly described as looking like an unmade bed, a staggering swagger that's spoiling for a fight with any pavement bold enough to take me on, and a fancy pulpit posh voice with brass knobs on, I've had my say. Now all I'm doing is saying it again, giving the works the works. In this first poem, which is a birthday poem, I went to bed at 29, awoke at 30, and took the New Quay countryside by surprise with an early morning walk when it wasn't looking. It was my 30th year to heaven, awoke to my hearing from harbour and neighbour wood and the mussel pool and the heron priested shore. The morning beckon with water praying and call of seagull and rook and the knock of sailing boats on the net-webbed wall. Myself to set foot that second in the still sleeping town and set forth. My birthday began with the water birds and the birds of the winged trees flying my name above the farms and the white horses. And I rose in rainy autumn and walked abroad in a shower of all my days. High tide and a heron dived when I took the road over the border, and the gates of the town closed as the town awoke.
Robert Lowell, the late American poet laureate, described the impact of Dylan meeting him in New York.
And I remember when I talked to him, he spoke of the incredible joy of life. But then some other point in the conversation, he was talking about the darkness, and he wasn't feeling too well that day. But the joy seemed very real, and the darkness seemed very real, and neither one seemed to exist without the other. Then later he wrote poems about the war, principally about bombing, and these rather magical, quite simple poems about childhood, such as Fern Hill and...
Now on Sir John's Hill, the heron ankling the scaly lowlands of the waves makes all the music, and I who hear the tune of the slow Were-Willow River grave, before the lunge of the night, the notes on this time-shaken stone for the sake of the souls of the slain birds sailing.
And that's there, and sex is very close to that. Sex, too, is sort of energy that destroys and creates.
From his adolescence to his end, Dylan had adored the screen goddesses. He would actually meet them in Hollywood. Shelley Winters and Marilyn Monroe and Charlie Chaplin. "I pissed on the plant in your porch," he said. And all the screen images swirled through his tour of fame. As he wrote to his New York friend, Lauren McIver, he admired Betty Grable's pylons, and he asked himself, is M. West a lesbian? Does Betty D. hustle? In parties out there, do the stars wear dishevelled? Did ever poor Dylan's onslaught on silence throughout his so cleverly agented odyssey raise any bustle? In the chromium homes on the hills of Beverly, hashish, hot splashes, nipple, nibble, and nuzzle. Did you paint Yale and Harvard O'Hara scarlet? Have a bash at the deans? Did you maestro their broads with a flash of cold muckle? Of course, Dylan knew of his deliberate degradation of himself and his talents. Once he was sent back home, sodden with liquor and with very little profit in his pocket. On his second odyssey across America, Captain went with him. But in their public rows and sousings, they became an embarrassment, as well as a legend. After visiting Max Ernst and the last of the surrealists, Dylan wrote a mock epitaph. In a gallant battle against American generosity, an American called Double Rye shot Catlin to death. I was scalped by a Bourbon. Posthumous love to you. And then, back in Wales, I wrote to a dear American woman friend, regretting the beautiful West, where men are sometimes men, and the bars are always exultantly open. What future can there be for the son of a sloth and a turnip? Either I hang by my whiskey toes, thinking of nothing and lust, or sit big-headed in the wet earth thinking of turnip poems and time snails by. And San Francisco is 6,000 lamenting miles away, and Wales is dead from the ice southward up. And day after day I grow lazier and fatter and sadder and older and deafer and duller. Gout snarls in my big toe. My children grow large and rude. I renounce my art to make money and then make no money. And what's a bloody poem worth anyway? In the end, a necessary ending. And death shall have no dominion. Under the windings of the sea, they lying long shall not die windily. Twisting on wrecks when sinews give way, strapped to a wheel that they shall not break, faith in their hands shall snap in two, and the unicorn evils run them through. Split all ends up they shan't crack, and death shall have no dominion. And death shall have no dominion. No more may gulls cry at their ears, or waves break loud on the seashores, where blue of flower may a flower no more lift its head to the blows of the rain. Though they be mad and dead as nails, heads of the characters hammer through daisies, break in the sun till the sun breaks down, and death shall have no dominion. Although he could not pay his own bills for his family, Catlin and Dylan took in his old parents at Larne.
I can't actually remember either my mother or father ever asking us to do one thing rather than another. There was no discipline in that sense at all. But we were never told off for running along the mud flats, where you could often cut your foot if you wanted, and it was a wonderful adventure playground.
And in the evening, he and Catlin would still have a few loving jars in Brown's. Dylan's collected poems had proved to D.J. Thomas that his son was the great poet the father had always wanted him to be. His last words were, "It's full circle now." Dylan wrote one of his greater poems on his father losing his sight.
Do not go gentle into that good night. Old age should burn and rave at close of day. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Though wise men at their end know dark is right, because their words had forked no lightning they, do not go gentle into that good night. Good men, the last wave by, crying how bright their frail deeds might have danced in a green bay, rage, rage against the dying of the light. Wild men, who caught and sang the sun in flight, and learned too late they grieved it on its way, do not go gentle into that good night. And you, my father, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now, with your fierce tears, I pray. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Dylan was still looking for his childhood as he prepared to die. I went up into Cwm Donkin Park, the childish, lonely remembered music fingering on in the suddenly gentle wind. Dusk was folding the park around like another, darker snow. Soon the bell would ring for the closing of the gates, so the park was empty. The parkkeeper walked by the reservoir where swans had glided on his rounds. I walked by his side and asked him my question. Up the swathed drives, past buried beds and loaded utterly still, furred and birdless trees, towards the last gate. He said,
"Oh, yes, yes. I knew him well. He used to climb the reservoir railings and pelt the old swans. Run like a billy goat over the grass you should keep off of. Cut the branches out of the trees. Carve words on the benches. Fight in the bandstand. Climb the elms. And moon up the top like an owl. Light fires in the bushes. Play on the green bank. Oh, yes. I knew him well. I think he was happy all the time."
"What has become of him now?"
"Dead, dead. Dead, 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 dead."
On his fourth and last lecture tour of America, Dylan usually stayed in New York at the Chelsea Hotel. He'd fallen into the local habit of popping pills along with his alcohol, a deadly mixture. This was the beginning of the drug culture of Greenwich Village, the uppers and downers to add to the booze at the White Horse Tavern. To keep himself performing, Dylan was taking benzodrine and sleeping pills, phenobarbital and atropine. He was suffering from occasional blackouts and was being given large amounts of cortisone and morphine. "Now I am a man no more, no more. And a black reward for a roaring life," sighed the old ramrod, dying of strangers.
"That guy can box.
I've had 18 straight whiskies. I think that's the record.
Two men in a ring."
In his later performances, Dylan looked as if he were about to expire. At the Young Women's Hebrew Association, the dying Dylan gave a last successful reading of Under Milk Wood. "To begin at the beginning. It is spring, moonless night in the small town, starless and Bible black." Two of the actresses, Nancy Wickwire and Sadie Thompson, remembered that performance.
"We went up to the office here at the Y. We all met up there, met Dylan for the first time, and went into Dr. Kolodny's office and proceeded to read it. And I, as I remember, none of us really thought that it was very readable. He wasn't a director at all. That's really the primary thing that all of us remember, I think, is loving the words, savoring the words the way he did.
On the last afternoon that we gave Under Milkwood, when he was desperately ill, we didn't think that we would be able to do the last performance because he was so ill. But he said he wanted to do it, and he said he would be all right. The doctor gave him a shot of something, and he seemed to recover. We got on stage in our respective stools, and the spotlight came on him, and he was very pale and very ill, and I know whatever nerves we had as actors were completely gone because we were all just so feeling for him. And I think that's probably one of the greatest theatrical moments I've ever known in my life, that when that light came up on him, sick as he was, all the lights came on, and it was the most beautiful, inspiring, fantastic performance he ever gave of the play.
Dylan fell ill in the Chelsea Hotel. His close friend and agent, Liz Rytel, remembered his going.
Dylan was sort of breathing very badly. And he was turning blue. He had gone unconscious. And the ambulance came, and we took him over to St. Vincent's Hospital. But he was in a coma, and he never came out.
Kathleen took her dead husband home. Evans the Death drove the body of the bard back from the liner at the docks to Larn.
Dylan could not bear to quit the beauty around him, but every birthday was the tolling of a bell. I hear the bouncing hills grow larked and greener at berry brown fall, and the dewlarks sing taller this thunderclap spring, and how more spanned with angels ride the mansouled fiery islands. Oh, holier than their eyes, and my shining men no more alone, as I sail out to die. Kathleen and her family and friends looked at Larn Castle and the bay where all their happiness had been. Other than in his poems, Dylan the Bard left behind him a play for voices, which captured the essence of seaside Wales, forever caught between dream and heaven and earth, beauty and darkness. As Dylan's friend Richard Burton said, Undermilk Wood was all about religion, sex and death.
Time passes. Listen. Time passes. An owl flies home past Bethesda to a chapel in an oak, and the dawn inches up. Stand on this hill. This is Llandegib Hill. Old as the hills, high, cool and green. And from this small circle of stones, made by the Druids for a come to visit Milkwood.
Seas covered with eels and mermen and whales. As true as I'm here, dear you, tomcat's tart. You land lover rosy, you cozy love, my easy, my true sweetheart.
Would you like this nice wet corset, Mrs. Ibre, too?
Would you like this nice wet corset?
No! I won't!
Oh, as I was young and easy in the mercy of his means, time held me green and dying, though I sang in my chains like the sea. In Welsh, Dylan means the son of the wave. He sings to us forever.
Gwenyn dirion and dahi.
through.